Thank you for joining the Tulsa Christian Businessmen. Presenting, Travis Meyer. The Tulsa Christian Businessmen meet every second Thursday of the month from noon to 1 at the Wyndham Hotel on 41st near Garnett. This video was sponsored by the Tulsa Regional Business Alliance. And now, Travis Meyer.
Is our Channel 6 main meteorologist, right? I want you guys to give a warm welcome to Travis Meyer.
Yeah. All right, it is great to be here today and hear all of the different things going on. Speaking of going on, it's amazing what's going on. I had to leave my 15-year-old son at home because he said, "Dad, what am I going to do today?" I don't know, go on your cell phone like you usually do and play different games and everything like that. Our society has changed so much. It is amazing, and especially for those, and Tim, and everyone else that's running, it's just amazing to watch what's happening in our society. And it seems to come to a forefront when you're in the media, because you're trying to stay ahead of the curve. Everybody's trying to do that. But we're trying to do it in a social way, and social media has taken on such a different meaning. And in the good old days of Don Woods and Frank Mitchell and Travis Meyer, when we were sitting there, and life was pretty easy, because we'd go to work and in the afternoon, 2-3 o'clock in the afternoon, do our weather, get all the weather forecasts together, present it, and then at 6:30 you'd head out the door and go straight home to eat, unless it was Oklahoma's spring weather like this, when you stayed there and just watched forever and ever. And then you'd come back at about 9 o'clock or so, get your latest updates, put it back in, make a few new maps. 10:30, you went out the door. You didn't let the door hit you in the rear as you were leaving. And that was pretty much life, other than maybe an opportunity to come and speak to a group. But now society has changed so much, and our social media has changed so much, that it's nonstop. I don't like people knowing my personal business, but it seems like everybody feels that that's what we need to be doing. I don't know how many of you have checked in today here at the hotel, but the majority of people want me to know what they're eating and where they're eating, and pictures of their food still. And I'm like, that's great, but our society, that's just how it is. And my son, trying to pry this silly little phone out of his hands, is it's almost like murder. Because, I mean, it's literally a fight every day, and I talk to more and more parents that are in the same situation, that our kids are growing up with just a monitor for their brain. And so I'm getting really concerned about what's happening, because in the course of the last 5 or 6 years, we have seen a huge shift in what's going on as far as what we're doing in TV. And what I wanted to do is just briefly touch on that, and I'm going to briefly touch on my life and some of the changes that have occurred, and then I wanted to end it with just a couple of things that I'd like for you to remember about the weather. First of all, within the realm of what we're doing at the TV station, I'll talk about severe weather in just a minute. But in terms of social media and what we're seeing, it is amazing what society is, what it's doing to us right now. Because we're getting new research in, because our goal is to maintain as many viewers as possible. But nobody wants to sit and wait for a newscast at 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, or 10 o'clock. And probably half of you in here, unless you just have some time, aren't going to do that, because you're just going to look and see what the latest story is, or wait and see if there's a what we call a push notification on what the latest thing that just happened, a robbery, you know, stat, whatever it is, schools that are out for the next day. That seems to be the biggest one that's blowing up my phone right now. So when we look at those things, that's what our society has come to, as we all know. We're starting to, we see that. The unfortunate thing, though, that I'm finding with my two boys, I have two boys that are 15 and 16, and I have daughters that are 26 and 30. So there's a wide gap. My boys were adopted when they were just a little less than 2 and 3 years of age. And just the things that I have seen in their life in just these last 10 years is just mind-boggling. And you've seen that with your children. You've probably seen it with your grandchildren. It is amazing. And so I take that to the Christian realm, and I think it's amazing what we have to do now that we didn't have to do before. Sitting in church doesn't seem to be as good of an option for so many kids. I've had a struggle in my life over the course of the last 3 or 4 years. I had to go through a divorce after being married for almost 30 years. I never dreamed that that would happen to my life, because I spent most of my time going to Promise Keepers, believing strongly in what was going on as far as family. Our jobs, and Frank can attest to this fact, that our jobs, just like many of your jobs, pull us away from who we are a lot of times, because we have to go when the weather goes, and that's it. You don't have any choices. And in the spring, you're not around. I don't know how many birthday parties we set up that I missed I can't even begin to count the times that I came home to a very sad family, a very unhappy spouse, and I kept saying, this is the life that we chose, this is what we have to do. The sacrifices, though, in today's world, don't seem to want to be sacrificed in terms of everybody has such a short period in which they can handle things like that. They get angry faster. Everybody's so fast. I'm driving down the turnpike just coming here today, and I was driving, well, it's supposed to be 65. I was driving about 70. People are passing me. Everybody's passing me. And I still go, why does everybody have to do this? But our society has come to that point. So about 4 years ago, my world came to a sudden and quick change because it suddenly was just like, what? No, this can't happen. And I have been preaching for so many years on family and on being a good spouse, being a good husband, because Promise Keepers was one of probably the best things that ever happened to me. And maybe that made my marriage last another 10 years. I don't know. But I felt committed to my family. But the unfortunate thing is my family disconnected with me because of some of the amount of time that I spent doing other things. And I also had a ranch. The ranch, though, everybody seemed to enjoy, and I thought that was a good thing. So 4 years ago, I suddenly had a come to Jesus moment because it was just like so many people. I had to go through the court system. I had to spend a year going through a divorce. It was pretty, less than pretty. We'll put it that way. I don't know of a divorce that is pretty. And it was a struggle for me, for my children, and it still is. And it has changed a lot of things in my life because literally I have custody of my 15-year-old son. And he's out of school, so I constantly have to take care because I don't have any help in situations like that. I have a 30-year-old daughter who's very, I don't want to say she's messed up, but she's just very upset. And my 26-year-old is upset. And it continues to go on and on. And I don't know what we do to fix what's going on now. I just know that being around men and women of God and a closer relationship is probably the best thing that can happen for so many of us. But it has been an interesting journey because it has been a struggle to be able to get up and smile in front of people when you just came out of a lawyer's office or out of court for that reason. And then when you have to go and right after that, you have to, after the initial divorces, hopefully none of you guys have had to do this, I'm sure some of you had, but in order to split up your kids and get to proper, what should we say, the way that the court system handles divorces and children and custody, you have to go to a special court hearing, and then you have to go with a group of people that are going through the same thing so that you learn a little bit more about how custody works and what it's like to be in divorce. It's set up. It's a good thing, but I'm sitting in there, and the room is packed more than this with people that are divorced. And it is, I was embarrassed probably because so many people knew me, but nobody really cared. Because everybody's there with the saddest faces I've ever seen or angry. And it's amazing the emotions that are going on at the break of our families. And when we look at I have a daughter who's 26 who's trying to get married, and her boyfriend, and they've been dating for 3 years, doesn't want to get married because he watched our divorce unfold. And so she's going like, Dad, I don't know what to do. And I said, I don't have a great answer. I thought I did, but I don't have a great answer, especially in today's society where we're trying to figure it out. And so the issue that I find is that I think that men and women that are Christians, that we really have to reinforce everybody else's marriage as well. And that was something I didn't do because I was so busy with my work and with my family. And after Promise Keepers, I kept in contact with a couple of my close friends. We went to church. I was a Sunday school teacher. My ex-wife was the assistant Sunday school teacher. It wasn't perfect, but it sure seemed like it. And so it seemed like everything was going well. But I don't think I've completely fulfilled my job, so to speak, or my position as a decent husband to finish. I knew what was coming around the corner gradually over the course of 2 years, and I didn't stop it. And I feel guilty for that. But what I'm saying is that I did it basically because when we have other alternatives in our life, which now there are so many alternatives, we have to find a way to push those away and focus on our families. And one of the things that I wish I could have done was maybe done that. It could have sacrificed my career, probably would have. I would have had to do something else. I also was trying to balance out the fact that my wife was used to having a new car every 2 or 3 years, and also that that was something that was important to her, and I was going to like, that wasn't going to happen ever again. So it was taking value of something that doesn't really mean anything, and I was putting that meant something, and I should have probably re-established some of my value systems that I had in place, because I thought that if I kept her peace, happy, she would be okay with me working hard. I never once veered away from my job or my family, but it doesn't matter sometimes. So what I'm saying is that, as I kind of went off on that tangent, I say that to say this, is that with society changes, I think that it takes every one of us now, and I have taken a whole new meaning to every time somebody's marriage is in shambles. And I know Jim, for example, works a lot with families and kids and people who are, and tries to get everybody together on the same level. And I know most of you do, so I'm preaching to the choir. But I just want to inspire that when you see somebody else's marriage that has difficulties, that you find a way to not get in the middle of their relationship, but to support that spouse that you know. Because I just can't believe what's happening to our society at this point, and that it's going to take us. My father, he's 88. He's farming. I went up and picked up a bunch of cattle from him just recently. Some tires that I bought from Mr. Robertson about 15 years ago I thought would make the whole trip, but they didn't. I'm just saying. I was tight. I should have bought some new tires. That's all I'm going to say.
Good rest,
the price had gone up a little bit, and so I just thought I could make one more trip.
Yeah.
He did. I had to go to him, and we just bought some new tires. Anyway, long story short, it's just that I went up there to see him and my mom. They're 88 and 83, and they farm. And they said, you take care of yourself, take care of your family? Yes. You're not working too much, are you? I go, well, yeah, I'm still working quite a bit because I have a lot of things I have to pay now for other people. And I said, so I'm still working. They said, well, don't you give up on your children. And I said, I'm not going to. But just that thought process of our older generation, somebody that's from, I'll say, 60 to 80 to 90, you know, there was still a work ethic, there was still a thought process that you don't screw up. You know, you work to the very end. And there were, when I grew up in a small town in Nebraska, there was only one person that got divorced that I can remember in the 19, 20 years that I lived at my home. And that was a big deal. And I think everybody in the community went to see them. But it was something that just didn't happen because everybody was, they had a little different standard. And they took time and they had patience, and nothing was perfect. I saw some ugly marriages, but I also saw a lot of them that probably could have said, I'm tired of you, and just left. But they didn't. They stuck through the tough times, and it ended up being good times. And I wish that our society could find a way that we could be tougher. And I think that it takes us to continue to try to slow down this wheel or this ball that's rolling downhill. And I'm getting tired of seeing all the divorces. And in a few moments where I took time in just the last year or two with people who are going through divorces, and literally, if you've been there and done that, you have a much, I would say I have a deeper appreciation than I have ever had in my life, because I know the pain and the agony and the crying and the tears that you go through as a man. That I didn't cry for 20 years. And I probably cried for every day, I would say, multiple times. I did it right before the weather. I tried not to think of my family while I'm going on TV. And there was a couple times where I was just a mess. And that was 6 months to 8 months later. And I was like, oh my gosh. And then I said to myself, I said, I'm going to have to get some help. And I had a friend that said, Travis, you've got to go see somebody. You can't do this on your own. And I was trying to be a man. And I was trying to say, oh, I can handle this. I'm good. And I was falling apart. And I'd lost 25 pounds, like I guess a lot of people do during their divorce. And I was sick. And I was not doing well. And I finally went to a counselor. And I wish I would have done that from the beginning, but I was too stubborn and thought that I could do this. I had God. I had me. And I was going to take care of it. But sometimes it takes a little bit more than that to see your way through some very difficult times. And I felt, because of my dad and because of the structure I had in my life, because I was church going and I was dedicated, and I don't feel like a solid brick, but I do, in terms of I know my faith in Christ. I know what it is, and I'm not going to veer from that. I have difficulties with people that do, in terms of why wasn't there somebody to help you? But I thought I could do that by myself, and I couldn't make it through that period. And finally, when I got counseling help, I was able to see that you, in situations like this where it involves your spouse and your family, it's a whole different story. And again, I hope many of you have not had to go through what I've had to go through, but it's still a bit of a torture, even 3 years, 3.5 years removed from the initial beginnings of it. But I again say that with that in mind, my thing is that with the way society is going, with the way that we have involved ourselves, and this has become our new brain, especially for the teenagers, I have a very good friend who's just, it's all they want to do is Snapchat. And I don't know if you sit there and watch kids, but I mean, it's devastating to see that that's all they're doing. My son sits in the back seat taking pictures of himself nonstop. And I'm like, what are you doing? Snapchat. I'm like, but you're taking a picture of yourself every 5 seconds. I said, yeah, it's cool. So we all do that. I'm like, why? You look the same. He said, well, I move my hood a little bit. And it makes me look cool. I'm like, oh my goodness. So I fight that with some of the thoughts that are going on. But I pray for our society. I pray for the men. Because I'm a man, I guess I pray for the men. I mean, somebody hopefully will pray for the women. I pray for them too. But I am, just so stuck on what I've had to go through on my side that I, when I see a man that's fallen or something like that, I have a whole new dedication to see if I can help them stand back up, because it's a whole different world. And and I still am learning a lot of things. And so I just put that in there just because it is something that I am very concerned with and the way our society is going. The problem that we have at the TV station is, as I said, with basically people who are older than 40 will watch the newscasts at 5, 6, 9, and 10. If you're in your 30s to 20s, especially 20s and teens, nobody cares. First of all, I didn't really care about news anyway. When I was young, because it didn't mean anything to me. I just wanted to look at the weather. And so that was the most fun thing I could ever think of. And the only reason I'd watch the newscast is just see the weather, because I wanted to see what the next storm was coming. So I'd get on the windmill and take pictures of it with my little camera that never worked. I don't know if you ever tried to take a picture of lightning with an Instamatic, Kodak Instamatic 104. That does not work. Anyway, The focus, though, that I would like to do, just, and I wanted to just share that with you, some of that personal information, just because as I have the opportunity, it is really tough on my boys. I had my son come to me just recently. He says, Dad, were your folks ever divorced? I said, no. And then he said, Dad, were you ever adopted? I said, no. He says, then you have no idea what it's like to be me. Mm-hmm. And so one of the hardest things that I've had to deal with is the fact that we committed to two children, and we weren't able to fulfill that. And if there's ever anything that'll tear me apart through the end, is probably just that thought, because I felt so bad, and it pretty much took me to my knees when he said that. And after that point, I said, I have got to do something better. And so I have prayed a lot, and that's where my inspiration comes, to help others that are caught in the same situation. And I hope that if you're involved in that ever, that you are able to do that as well. From the personal standpoint that I have, that's all I'm going to say about that. But my strength, in Christ has not changed ever, and is stronger now than ever based on that. It's very hard in today's society, especially in TV, where Don Woods used to go out and preach, and he'd do his talks with Gusty and do all those things, because he'd come back to the TV station and say, yeah, I was just at this and so-and-so church doing Gusty and Salvation with Gusty. And I don't know if some of you were ever at some of those church prayer groups or places, men's groups. It might have been even like, I don't know if Don Woods was here. Yeah. And so, and he used Gusty, and I was just like, oh man, what a great guy to have to work for. It was incredible to work with him and just know that his inspiration. I always thought he was the tightest man in the world, that he squeaked when he walked, because that man loved to keep money. But I tell you what, he gave it away to anybody at work that needed anything. If there was a woman who had kids whose husband had left or passed away, he was spending hundreds of dollars. And I mean, back then, hundreds of dollars meant something rather than thousands now, like it has to be. But he was an inspiration to me as to what can happen. And people like that are what I really appreciate. Anyway, I just want to say that in the beginning, and it's not just because Frank's here, but I was going to use this as an example anyway. Frank and I were working together. It was Frank and I working together. And that was it. And so if there was a storm, it was both of us. And the next day, somebody had to wake up and do the morning show.
Yeah.
Or not sleep. Yeah, that was it. So it has been an evolving thing, where science has changed so much in terms of, we have so much more data. We also live in Oklahoma, where more people are obviously interested in what the heck is going on, because we get into some really nasty things occasionally. Our staff of meteorologists changed a little bit. Dick Farrow, I hated losing Dick, because Dick was probably one of the most intelligent meteorologists I have ever been around. Great Christian guy. And he would just say, you really going to put that on TV? I'm like, what? That's not a very good forecast. And he would just be honest with me. He'd do that on TV. After I moved from Channel 8 to Channel 6, he'd look at me and go, what'd you say? That's not correct. That storm is moving northeast at 30, not east at 20. And he'd say that on TV, and I was like, Dick, can you just tell me that off the air? just help me out just a little bit. But anyway, he was like one of those guys that you just don't, I don't know. He's just perfect for his position. He kept me in line. And I've really, you know, he was the one that, and I wish Frank could have worked with him, because he was one of the meteorologists that is absolutely, you know, was a teacher even after we were taught. And our new staff, Lacey has taken his place, and she's going to be amazing. And plus she hunts, and she puts her hand down into these holes and picks out fish. It's the grossest thing I've ever seen in my life. And she's pretty, and how she does that, I have no idea. That just doesn't make any sense at all. But she loves to do that. She has a scar above her eye where she, I forgot what that's called, when you're not quite ready to shoot your gun, and it shoots back in the scope. And she has a little thing above her eyebrow for that. She looked pretty ugly there for a while when she got hit. She's back to looking great now. The rest of the staff, Alan, and I'm just pointing out, Mike, Lacey, Stephen. You don't get to see Stephen on the bottom right very often. He helps me an awful lot, and he's on the morning shows. But a lot of our guys are young, and so they don't know a whole lot about global warming. So I just wanted to just touch on this for a moment, because I know this is a hot button topic for everyone. And I'm going to prove to you that global warming is occurring. And I'm going to show you this because I have an expert discussion group showing up. Hillary's part of it, the Pope is part of it, and then Donald Trump's hair. And Donald Trump's hair is probably one of the main reasons why we have global warming. But if you do not believe in global warming, you might have seen this next slide before, but you cannot argue with this next slide. I'm going to tell you there is no science in the world that will top this. And I'm proving to you today, global warming is occurring. Sorry, you can argue with that all you want, but I've got pictures and proof.
Oh my gosh.
If that doesn't tell the story, nothing does. So don't argue about global warming ever again, okay? So I'm going to move on for a minute. The Earth is constantly changing, and because the Earth is constantly changing, there's a whole lot of things that go on, and we always have cooling periods, we always have heating periods, and we're in a heating period. There's no doubt. This is a heating period compared to where we have been. And you can see that from just this graph, and it's, I don't want you to look anything other than this is back in 1978, and then that goes up to, what is that, Frank came with 2016. And you can see how there's more red to the right and how there's more blue to the left. And some of that, a volcano or two volcanoes can change things. Just because of the amount, what's in the atmosphere. There are more people on the earth. We know that. I know there's more people in Tulsa because I'm getting squeezed from my little ranch because there's so many housing additions. So I got to be careful so I don't spray and kill their things. But the earth itself is, you know, is warming a little. Tulsa is not really warm much. The nighttime lows have, but we expect that because the city has gotten larger, more urban sprawl, as we call it. So as the city has gotten larger, that has created more of a heat island effect, which we would never really have before because Tulsa was small, say in the 50s and 60s. But as we've looked at history and going through the 80s, 90s, and now, and if you stop and think, especially for those of us who've been in Tulsa for 20, 30 years, it's a lot different city than what it was. There's, you know, we'd be outside, we'd be in a pasture right now, you know, whatever it was 30 years ago, something like that, because, I mean, there just wasn't much right here. And so things have changed. And so we see that slowly, so we don't always stop and think about that. We know the sun is extremely powerful, but what we've been able to see with the sun and what's going on right now is that the sun hasn't changed. So what is going on is that our Earth is, we're doing a few things on the Earth that are making some changes. I am not a proponent, and I make a joke out of the global warming thing. I am not a proponent of global warming. It's science. It's what it is. And so I think people who make a little bit more of a religious context with it, you know, and go one way or another, you've got to just use common sense. God gave us our brain to use and use common sense. You know, it's just like driving out of here. You use your turn signals, better chance you're not going to get hit, you know, if you're smart, all that. And that's just what I want to be able to do with what's going on. And what I want to do, too, is we're in a small La Nina pattern, and I'm going to skip through a couple graphics quickly because I'm running out of time. And the El Nino impacts, which were last year, was wet and kind of rainy. And so much of Oklahoma was fine. Western Oklahoma, I don't know if you've watched the TV lately, but over 190 days without a quarter inch of rain in the panhandle of Oklahoma. 190 days without a quarter inch. I mean, that's like, you know, it's the, I can't even begin to fathom how doggone dry that is. I mean, that's amazing. And some of that is now the effects of La Nina. And one of the things I want to bring to the forefront with La Nina is that in 2011, when we had a strong La Nina, and we don't have one right now, but the effects of La Nina are a little bit more rampant in terms of power and what can happen. Some of the things, lowest temperature ever, 31 below zero. I can't believe that in Oklahoma. You know, I grew up in Nebraska and said, I'm going to Oklahoma. I don't have to ever deal with this again. But it happened. 24-hour snowfall. We had over 2 feet of snow in Spavinaw. Most April tornadoes was 50. Highest recorded winds in El Reno at the surface, 151 mile per hour. Largest hail. Number of triple digit days, 101 days out of the year that were at or above 100. That was an awful year. And, you know, and it continued on into the following year as well. So we ended up with a whole bunch of weird things. La Niñas tend to do a little bit more weird things than El Niños. So that's the only thing I was just going to bring to the forefront. And some of the biggest, and when we've had La Niñas, and I know it's kind of a little hard to see, but where there's red, these are kind of La Niña things where we've had major tornado outbreaks. And if you look at the major Oklahoma tornado outbreaks, so you just look at the red, it gives you an idea. I think I spelled neutral. Oh, that's so embarrassing. I just happened to notice that. Anyway, just note that more La Niñas have higher probabilities of tornado outbreaks, even though we don't end up with a ton of rain normally. The way the weather has changed a lot, severe weather warnings, you know, you guys get them on the phones now. We get a whole bunch of different types of ways to see them. Tornadoes, this is just a graphic of the tornadoes in Oklahoma from 1950 to 2017. Looking for the red and the oranges are the ones that are the worst by far. Some of these are back into the 80s. Some went down by ORU. We were at ORU yesterday. I was just talking about that. We have had only an F5 tornado, EF5 tornado, come into the west side of Tulsa, and that was, I think, 1960. Started in Shawnee, Oklahoma, but we have been very fortunate. Now, here's where I want to mention a few things. The weather has become a lot more technical. We chase storms and tornadoes with helicopters. I mean, we would take the helicopter we had at Channel 8 and go after the tornado and look at the damage. We wouldn't take a helicopter and go chase a tornado. We didn't have monster storm teams. It was, for example, me and Frank, and this is a little bit different now, as you see an entire statewide team. And then I just double punched. I wanted to go back. Let's see if this will work. Let's see. This was the look at the tornado from the Owosso area. It's not going to play for me. But when you're looking from the tornado, you know, it's a game to half the people. And even though you have qualified people to go out and do that, we're worried about emergency personnel and everything else. This is one of my favorite pictures because it says, Broken Arrow welcomes you, and that's a wall cloud. And it turned out to be a tornado right after that. So I can imagine somebody coming in from another part of town going, oh, that's great. This is what we call a rotating wall cloud. Just in case you want to know, this happened to the south. This was down around Lake Eufaula. And so this is, again, as you look at what's rotating, a lot of times, right out of the center of that, you can have vortices come up, which are just small spin-ups of tornadoes. And overall, the whole wall cloud fall or comes down to the ground. That basically becomes the tornado itself. And it looks like it's slow, but you have to remember that that's a fairly significant size. And so it really gets wrapped up and turns into pretty vicious things around here. So this is the time of year when we're looking at that. This is a Sand Springs tornado. On the top is just the plane radar. On the bottom, I want you to look where there's red and green that come together right in here. And this is what makes our life so much better than it was in the 1980s. In the 1980s, you could not tell where a tornado was. You just had an idea just based on some of the radar signatures that are out there. For example, this type of radar signature that was a hook. You could tell some motion was trying to make that happen. Now we can see the raindrops and see what direction they're going. And you see a little green and a little red right there. And that is associated with where the tornado was located. This is a, and you know, we talk about damage, we talk about tornado stuff like that. What I want to do, lowest floors, I know you guys, I'm not going to sit here and preach about all the things that are out there. I am going to mention though that it just, if you have a practice, just to make sure you know where everything is. And for those of us who are 60 years of age or older, I'm going to get to the, let's see if I can get to the, I don't think it's on this one, medicine. I never thought I'd ever take so much medicine, but I take quite a few pills, and I never thought I'd have to, but I take enough. Anyway, make sure you have a little baggie of medicine available for a day or two. What I've found after we've gone in after some of these tornadoes, people, you know, you don't have your medicine closet, you don't have anything related to anything that's normal. And a lot of us have to have our medicine daily. And you don't have time when you're trying to put your life back together in that particular moment to go do that. And then you can kind of get sick fast, you know, or you've got to leave and got to go get your medicine someplace. And hopefully your drugstore is still there or whatever. But it's one of those things that if you can do and have just a small baggie with you when you go to your shelter, it's really been a good idea if you are ever caught in that place. And I've never, maybe that's my medicine there. Okay, I didn't push the last button. You can't see it very well at the bottom. Here's what I want to talk about, and I'll do this fast because we are,
Take your time.
Okay, I got 2 minutes. Okay, all right, talk fast. This is my storm shelter, what I grew up in. Not really, but awful close. It was kind of scary. We didn't have snakes in Nebraska, but there's snakes all over. This is the, I want to just take you through the Joplin tornado in 2 minutes. This is a picture of Joplin in the upper right. And I know for you guys in the back, it's too hard to see, but the tornado went through the central part of Joplin. This is an enhanced view of that area where the tornado went through and the locations of some of the schools. Fortunately, it was Saturday, so there wasn't schools in session, but it did hit an area that had a lot of populated areas as far as housing, residential, and then it also hit an area that had a lot of commercial activity right in here. Then what I want to show you is that you see the tornado on the upper left, and you can see that even though it's small. This is a look at the Walmart in Joplin before the tornado. This is a look at the Walmart after. And this is a EF4 to EF5 damage of what, and we thought this tornado, this severe outbreak was going to be Tulsa. And it ended up being Grand Lake on up to Joplin. This is a look at the Home Depot. And then afterward, the Home Depot. So the visualization I just want you to see is that it's there's so many stories that came out of Joplin, and it was a great place to learn lessons on what can happen. You don't want to be by the big outside walls because there's no support in a big structure such as that, free span roofs. That is a very dangerous place to be no matter how you cut it. You can get to the bathroom, hopefully that's good, and it doesn't have one of those big concrete 30-foot walls on the side because they just flop over because they're just not built for a tornado. You know, just like churches. This is St. John's Hospital, not here, but in Joplin. This is before the tornado. This was after the tornado. I could go through so many stories of the triage centers, of all the things that happened. There was a nurse who did a story and did a presentation at St. Francis while I was there about a year and a half, 2 years ago, that was stunning what they had to go through. And I mean, imagine, it's like a St. Francis, a Hillcrest. And it was hit by a tornado, EF5 tornado. And so these are the things that shouldn't happen very often, and they don't, thank God. But unfortunately, when they do, they can cause a lot of damage. And the velocity of the wind is stunning. Now, the only thing I want to share with you on this is that this is a housing addition. Again, it's hard to see. It's just a housing addition with a couple of areas that are basically just wooded. These are just trees there, the kind of the brown stuff. Then there's a little blue right here. This was afterward, and you can't see it very well, but it's all destroyed. And it's just totally destroyed in that area. The blue area that I'm highlighting is the driveway right in here. And right there where you see that yellow arrow is where there is actually white boxes located. That white box is a safe room. And just in the last, I would say, 10 to 15 years, the technology has gotten so good. Everybody said, you've got to be below ground if there's an EF5 tornado because we're all going to die. Well, the technology is so good now. Titanium bolts hold it down, 3/8-inch thick steel reinforced. All of that comes together, and that has made it so you can survive a tornado above ground. This is very important. Once again, I'm going to go to the 60 and older crowd. But if you have someone in a wheelchair, if you have someone who can't get down into a Frady hole, this is a very fast, easy thing to do to get into, and it makes it so much easier if you have pets. It makes it so much better for us. So I just want to point out that now technology, you know, I always get mad at how technology has changed. We still have below ground shelters. This one in Moore had, I think it was for 12, and they put 15 people, and one person was laying on top of everybody right in Moore because they just stuffed everybody they could inside of it, and everybody ended up safe. But it gives you an idea of all the different things. The last thing is that flooding, this is weather fatalities. And I wanted to look at the yellow because that's the average, went through 2016. Flooding, lightning, and tornadoes. You can see flooding is the worst. And I always talk about tornadoes, but you still have to watch out for lightning. More men are killed by lightning because we're stubborn and we want to stay out and play golf just a little bit longer. And we're going to make it because that storm's still far enough away. we're the ones, usually men are at a much higher risk than women. Women have a little bit more safety, maybe more brain. I don't know what that is, but it works, whatever it is. And then notice heat as well. And a lot of children and a lot of elderly people. All right, that's all I'm gonna share with you except for this closing. These are emails I've received. I don't know if you, okay. Dear Travis, why do you spend 30 minutes talking about a storm that never changes? Why do you report on storms so far away from Tulsa? It doesn't make a stinking difference on Tulsa. You mentioned so many places that aren't even in our viewing area. Go get a map, learn how to read the map, and then talk to us. I think I'd use the word suck in here, but you people suck. Why don't you let us watch what you screwed up? There was no tornado. You're an idiot. These are some of my favorite ones. Why is it that if there's a little storm in Tulsa, you'll stay on the air nonstop? But if we have storms down here, you come on the air, oh, maybe once an hour? Thanks for taking care of us. Not. The National Weather Service call you were running this time at 8:59 is so far out of the Channel 6 viewing area that Channel 6's signal would not have even reached it with the best ionospheric skip on record. Why do you have to do that? You are idiots. That seems to be a common theme. Let me do the last one here since we're out of time. This is probably my favorite one. Travis, did your mom not hug you enough when you were a kid? You are an attention freak. You're a prima donna. You spent 27 minutes earlier tonight saying the same thing over and over and over. You showed pictures of a dark Bartlesville that were so bad you couldn't even tell if they were Bartlesville. It could have been any place. Do you really think people were actually sitting there watching you in Bartlesville with death and destruction only minutes away? No. They'd already hauled their rears up and got someplace safe. And I bet they didn't take their stupid freaking TV with them either. Say what you have to say, then shut the hell up. You do this crap every time there's a dark cloud or a breeze messes up your hair. What little you have left. That was wrong. Get some help, man. Find the Lord. Oh. Collect stamps. For God's sake, quit being a camera freak. So that's the way we end it with the weather, right, Frank? All right, thank you guys. I know we're out of time.
I wrote one of those, but.
Thank you for your time, guys.